Okay, well, welcome to the 11th lecture of European integration. Today's a really exciting topic. I'd like to apply the principles we've discussed in the past couple of lectures on the idea of an optimal currency area to Europe. Try to apply some empirical evidence, or examine some empirical evidence, apply some empirical tests to see if Europe actually cuts the mustard, whether it actually is surviving, has a potential to survive in the sense of Mundell or McKinnon, Cannon, all the other people who have written on monetary unions and optimal currency areas. So I'll review the last lecture, and then we'll talk about these conditions again. And then I'll talk a little bit more about credibility. In my view, the real economic gains from monetary union are also important. So Mundell is right, but in my opinion, the extra criteria that are named by Baldwin and Wiplos in their book are also important. One of those is credibility. The idea that if you're in a country that has had a high inflation rate for decades, it makes sense maybe to tie your hands. And we already discussed the framework for thinking about that, and I'll review that again. That's the Barrow-Gordon framework. We'll talk about some of the nuances of this idea. If you were taking the master's course, we'd actually write down a mathematical model and solve it, because it's a nice optimization problem. You can also do it dynamically, all sorts of tricks you can bring to bear on the question. But in a bachelor's course, I think it's good enough to do it diagrammatically, graphically, to understand the principles behind it. Then I'll talk about the exchange rate in detail, about it, its function as an adjustment mechanism. This goes along the lines of what McKinnon wrote in his famous work on monetary union, common currency areas. He spoke about the role of non-traded goods, and I'd like to highlight that because if you look at the situation in Southern Europe, a lot of the interesting adjustment has had to occur through non-traded goods prices. And I'd like you to understand why that's an important aspect of being in a monetary union. Until now, we've talked a lot about traded goods. In the real part of the course, we talked about trade of goods and services, and there's a lot of service trade as well. But here I'm talking about things that cannot be traded. And those goods have to also change in price, and if they don't, or if they do it more slowly, then it could put an excess burden on the people who actually work in that sector. It could also cause unemployment. It may cause a stubbornness in the price mechanism that may impede adjustment in the sense of our ASAD model. Okay, and then I'll spend most of the time talking about Europe and the evidence given these questions. So that last bullet point is actually a very large part of today's lecture. Last time we talked about the advantages and disadvantages of a fixed exchange rate regime. You should be clear that there's no real clear-cut case. You should understand that there's not a real clear-cut case. I would submit that a good debater could make the case for any country having the exchange rate flexible or fixed. But a good economist would look at the actual evidence to see if the one or the other factor is more important or whether people put more value on it. So when you think about a fixed exchange rate regime, you're actually asking the same question about an optimal currency area. There are just different ways of adjusting, and clearly the world is not a currency area, but Berlin isn't an optimal currency area either. I mean, Berlin has not suffered from sharing the Deutsche Mark or the Reichsmark or the Euro with the rest of Germany or the rest of the European Monetary Union. I think it's hard to deny. And yet we still have to discuss these ideas. And we're talking about a Keynesian world, a world where the price level doesn't adjust instantaneously. So that's why monetary matters are important, right? If you don't believe that, then you should probably just not adhere to any of this discussion. Because if you had a world without frictions, without price rigidities, it wouldn't really matter whether you had a euro or the Japanese yen. We could just adopt another currency anytime we want. But that apparently has an effect in the short run in response to shocks and the time it takes to adjust. And that's why Mundell writing more than 50 years ago, basically looked at these ideas. And we talked about modifications and extensions. There's quite a bit. This is legitimate exam material, understanding these ideas. And if you're really ambitious, you'll take a look at the original papers. They're not that difficult. The original paper by Mundell is very short. And then I talked about tying your hands. So the idea of buying into a monetary union is a way of committing yourself to a certain policy that you can't execute in a credible way on your own. So this is related to the idea of time consistency of optimal policies that we talked about, or you've talked about in other macro courses. Famous paper by Kidlin and Prescott is a fantastic example of that. And if people don't believe that you're going to do the policy, do the heavy lifting, they won't believe that you're going to stay. And inflationary expectations might be very durably higher than in other countries. So looking at Southern Europe, comparing it to Northern Europe, one thing we noticed immediately after the monetary union was inflation was persistently higher in Southern Europe. And a lot of people said, well, that's just because non-traded goods, they're developing fast, and you'll see this in a second. But it could also be that people just didn't believe that inflation was going to be low for a long time because they didn't really believe their own country would stay in the euro area for a long time. So these are two competing explanations of what's happening. So let's review the benefits and costs of being in this arrangement. This is in the book. You have reduced transactions costs. That's obvious. Anyone who's a tourist knows that there's a huge spread. If you travel to England, the bid-ask spread on pounds is quite large for a small tourist like yourself. If you're a bank, of course, you pay less. And if you're a big bank, you pay even less. But that is a different question. So you're going to spend a fair amount of money changing money. And this may not bother you much if you're a domestic person, you don't travel. But if you're involved in trade, it could make a difference. There's also uncertainty involved. And this uncertainty can be reduced if you have a single currency. That's kind of obvious. Of course, you still have price uncertainty, but you don't have the exchange rate uncertainty. And I showed last time that the German-French trade relation has benefited immensely from having a constant nominal exchange rate. Okay? It doesn't solve all your problems. Obviously, if you have a country with rigidities on the real side, if you have labor market issues, or if your product market isn't responding, we'll talk about those things next week, you're still going to have problems. Economic growth presumes that the motor is running properly. Okay, so having a common currency isn't going to solve all your problems. And it won't solve any problems if you don't admit that you have problems. The benefits extend to the quality of monetary policy. That's one of the last points I'll make on this issue today. Namely, you buy into a better monetary policy. Liberia adopted the U.S. dollar many decades ago, actually a century and plus ago. Panama, there must be some reason for that. I mean, maybe it's just better just to go, right? Zimbabwe vanquished the inflation, the big hyperinflation in 2008, adopted the U.S. dollar. Now, the problem is, if you don't have any U.S. dollars in the economy, it's kind of hard to use it as a means of exchange. So to get the dollars, you have to have an export surplus. There are all sorts of minor, quite major issues involved in adopting some country's currency, and it's an advantage to the issuer of the currency. So this is one of these small side details. You have to run a surplus to get the stuff. You have to give your goods, your valuable goods, for pieces of paper or some sort of purchasing medium credits at a bank in the United States or in Germany, in the European Union. The cost of having a common currency we've talked about, and they show up in the Mundell discussion. You don't have any flexibility in the sense of being able to devalue. And this may not be a big deal if you're Iceland, but the experience shows that even Iceland benefited from its large depreciation in 2008-09 after they had problems in the onset of the financial crisis. Okay, so the devaluation instrument is not available to Greece unless it leaves the Eurozone, but it's certainly available to Iceland, certainly available to the United Kingdom. It's available to Europe as a monetary union vis-a-vis the United States. Everybody get that? It's kind of a basic point. And of course, if you have diversity and you have asymmetric shocks, you're in trouble. Asymmetric real shocks mean that region A is getting hit by a different disturbance than region B, and you know, without an exchange rate, you're not going to be able to deal with that either. Okay, and then finally, the fact, and this is probably the most important thing we're observing right now, is that people have different attitudes towards monetary policy, whether medium inflation, as we observe in Turkey, for example, is a big deal or not. I grew up in a time when inflation was as high as 15% per year. Okay. Since the 1980s, it's been very low in the United States, and it's also been very low in this country and in Switzerland, but that's not the case in other countries. So that's a very important issue to deal with. Maybe people don't like giving up their autonomy to choose their own inflation rate. Ultimately, that's what monetary policy buys you in the long run, because we believe the long run implies some sort of monetary neutrality. The central bank actually can target an inflation rate in the long run. Okay, so these are the criteria we talked about. This is, again, review. Mundell, the famous two criteria. Criterion one is the mobility of production factors, not just labor. Mundell spoke mostly of labor, but also you can think of capital. And secondly, symmetry of shocks. That goes right into the disadvantage category, advantage category we spoke of earlier. Peter Kennan's criterion of diversification is interesting, or similarity. So there's no gain from using the exchange rate as an instrument to correct terms of trade imbalances. McKinnon talked about openness in trade and the lesser importance of non-traded goods. We'll get to that in a second. Jeffrey Sachs and Paul Krugman have spoken about transfer systems. This is talked about quite a bit in the current context. Europe doesn't have that. I mean, Europe has this common agricultural policy, which takes about half or maybe a third of the European budget and redistributes it to agricultural intensive countries to keep prices from falling and maintain some sort of certainty of supply. Certain countries have benefited a lot from those transfers, but they're not very big. They don't really come close to what we observe in the United States or in Brazil, between the regions of Brazil or the probably the regions of Russia. So if you don't have that common government, because we want to have a democratically controlled system, we'd like to have a system where the transfers are voted on and people agree mutually, either ex ante to have an insurance system or ex post, well, we got to help these guys out. But it has to be democratically legitimate, at least in the Western perspective. Okay, and if you don't have a Western perspective, you can still do it, but somebody has to decide. To transfer resources from one place to another, irrespective of who actually produced those resources. So you need to be able to tax, and you need to be able to transfer. Baldwin-Whiplow's stress, the common preferences, which shows up in the idea of having the inability to have low inflation on your own, because you've just got a bad reputation. People don't trust you. They don't particularly like holding your money, and if they have a chance, they'll hold dollars or euros or some other currency. And that goes into the final issue of credibility gains, the last point. Let's talk about credibility a little bit, just to drive home the point. So again, making reference to a potential exam question, I'd like to see some ability to manipulate this setup in pictures. The Treaty of Maastricht and the convergence criteria make specific reference to the inflation rate. They make specific reference to the long-term interest rate, and they make explicit reference to the exchange rate. All those are nominal variables. The nominal interest rate is mostly inflationary expectations, long-term government bonds. The exchange rate, the stability of the exchange rate in the sense of having an EMS arrangement, is like expecting people to expect that they will have no chance of an abdication of the exchange rate, changing the exchange rate in some radical way. And these three mechanisms indicate that those countries joining that had high inflation, Italy is a good example, Greece, Portugal, Spain, but also Ireland, faced some sort of cost initially to get into the monetary union. Because normally you have to, just taking the IASAD perspective, if the central bank announces a lower inflation target, the effect of that is to shift the curve that we call the AD curve to the left. Okay, so the commitment is to have a lower inflation rate, so there's going to be a recession. This is a classic way that monetary policy is executed in modern capitalist economies. It sounds awful, that's the way it is. You can't just tell people inflation is going to be low, you have to prove it. Okay, and that's the this type of adjustment is exactly what the high inflation countries had to go through when they joined the euro, or they got ready for the euro in the late 1990s. And that's why credibility showing up as the expectation of inflation as it's embedded in contracts, or as we call it, core inflation or underlying inflation, is so important. Okay, so the model I spoke of last time, I'll repeat it quickly. This is a diagrammatic way of exploring these issues. One is the time consistency issue. That is, if I make a statement, I make a promise, do I actually follow through with it? Or having influenced you to take decisions on that statement, it's actually in my interest not to execute my promise. That's called time consistency. Okay, it was most vividly exposited in this paper, this famous paper by Finn Kidlin and Edward Prescott in the Journal of Political Economy about 40 plus years ago, looking about, and there's some really great examples that have nothing to do with money, monetary policy. If you like to live on the coast of a country where there are a lot of hurricanes, and there are enough of you, and you're in a country where voting is important and democracy is important, you know, the government doesn't like to bail people out, but you could, these people could say, well, you know, I'm just going to live here, and if a storm comes, I know the government's going to help me. I'm not going to get insurance, because I know, ex post, the government says they're not going to help me, they're not going to bail me out, but in fact, people move to the coast and live there. If there is a storm, the government really feels obliged to do something about it, and they usually do. And there's no way you can actually force these people to do anything else except to physically remove them from the place. Okay, so that's a good example of time consistency. Another good example is when a child misbehaves, the father or the mother says, I'm gonna punish you, and then the kid keeps doing it, and then of course, then the parent is challenged to actually execute the punishment. It doesn't have to be corporal punishment, any type of punishment will induce some pain on the part of the parent. The parent doesn't want the kid to suffer. So it's not a credible threat. Okay, so the same thing is true of monetary policy. And why is that the case? Why is it hard for a central bank to fulfill its promise? We saw this last time. Well, one is the central bank may have tastes that are deviating from what we think of as the long run. So the central bank is convinced that it can actually inflate the economy regularly and stimulate it. Most central banks don't do that. Most central banks actually like low inflation. But they're under pressure from, and this is very important for next week. Who puts pressure on the central bank?
Government.
Right. Because the government doesn't technically run the central bank. To be credible, the government kind of pretends like it's divorced from the central bank. The central bank is independent. And usually it is in some constitutional way. But if push comes to shove, the central bank is the last resort. The central bank can create money to fund a budget deficit, to bail out the banks, to do anything, to start a war. And the governments often make use of that. So if you look at the history of many central banks in the world, it's a great topic. This is one of the problems. Again, the credibility problem comes up. So the premise is this ASAD model is in the background, but the central bank ultimately has control over the position of the AD curve, which ultimately determines the inflation rate in this model. We're talking about a model where there's a natural rate of output. Okay, there's an output gap that can be positive or negative, but that gap is defined with respect to some long-run trend output. And the central bank, to a first order, can't affect that. Now, there's some people out there who believe the central bank can, but sort of the mainstream economic thought on this is that monetary policy is good for determining inflation and possibly in the short run determining output and employment and the rest, but in the long run, If your economy is stuck, it's for other reasons. It's not because of monetary policy. Okay? And the last assumption is very important. Private agents are clever enough to actually understand what the central bank's incentive structure is. Here's the picture. The tilde is the core inflation or underlying inflation. Pi bar is the target that the central bank has declared to be its target. So this is a long run. Output is at, and I've, instead of using the output gap, I've got the output level there just to make it very clear. You can always normalize by subtracting the output like the IMF does in their semi-annual World Economic Outlook forecasts and publications. So the LAS is the long run. It's any inflation rate is consistent with being at the output that we call the equilibrium sort of potential output. Okay, so the central bank has this ability basically to commit to a higher inflation rate. The European Central Bank has done that. In many ways, it's actually caused the inflation rate in the Eurozone to rise in the past 6 months by engineering a depreciation of the euro, by giving a lot of credit potential to the banking system. It's clear it's not used in all particular countries, but certainly in some, the growth of credit has increased, and therefore the money supply has increased, and demand has recovered. Europe has other problems as well. We'll talk about those, but the central bank is not a weak player in this game. So this is the classic sort of, and you can think of it the other way too. The central bank could reduce its target rate of inflation, shift the AD curve to the left, and after a recession, the inflation rate will be lower. Okay. There's a lot of discussion, by the way. The IMF, Olivier Blanchard, the chief economist of the IMF, has openly endorsed a higher target rate of inflation for the big central banks of the world, because he claims, potentially correctly so, that at a higher target rate of inflation, you have more room to maneuver in case of a recession, because the nominal interest rate will be lower if you have a low target rate of inflation. And if you have a recession, you can't really cut your interest rate. You have this zero lower bound problem. At least as the current state of affairs, we can't have negative interest rates. So the idea behind the Barrow-Gordon setup is that there's preferences of the central bank, and they look like this. Think of this as the indifference curves of the central bank, or indifference contours. So central bank might be equally unhappy or happy with an inflation rate on the left side of one of those hills and on the right-hand side. And that's just because the central bank has a different valuation of output relative to inflation. Of course, the central bank would be happiest down here at B. That's the bliss point. In this particular case, the central bank actually is interested, if it could only do it in the long run, it would be blissful, but it can't. We know that the real economy is a constraint on the central bank's behavior, and that's specifically going to prevent it from doing that. But you could imagine a world where B coincides with Y bar at zero inflation. That would be like a central bank that kind of knows, well, I can't do anything about it in the long run, so why bother in the short run? And I'm insulated from political pressure. So maybe the Swiss National Bank, you might think of that. But even the Swiss National Bank is subject to pressure, believe me. So this, it's impossible to really claim complete indifference about inflation. Okay, so formally you could do this by doing this could be a set of parabolas or circles. You can have fancy curves. I mean, there's a mathematical way of designing these types of indifference curves. But the most important thing you should remember is that you get happier. The central bank is preferring all points that are closer to B. And as you cross the contours, you're increasing your utility or your objective measure of success. So layering the ADS on top of that, you've got this obvious situation. Well, if B is to the right of Y bar, you're going to have an incentive. You're going to have this pull, this desire. If you can get away with it, even for a short run, especially if your discount rate is fairly high, to go for a short run blast of inflation and move from the first green dot at the intersection to this green dot. And you can see here the marginal rate of substitution of inflation versus output for the central bank is equal to its objective trade-off, which is the supply curve of agents in the economy. That's the formal statement. Okay, and you can see that by moving from this point to this point, the central bank has crossed, you know, a lot of indifference contours that lie above the one that it's reached. So it's increased its utility by doing this. And a classic exam question would be to demonstrate that under certain conditions, this type of action is not going to happen. Okay, you can also imagine a nasty central bank where B lies to the left of Y bar, but that's kind of implausible, right? Remember, inflation benefits certain classes of people and hurts other people. So if you're a pensioner, low inflation is good for you. If you're a farmer, high inflation benefits you because high inflation tends to hit agricultural prices first. It's a classic problem that's been discussed for 150 years. Okay? So, you know, keeping that in mind, that's the outcome if people retain the expectation of pi bar and the central bank secretly tries to do it higher and shifts out the AD curve. I haven't drawn that, but you can imagine the AD curve shifting. And, of course, if people aren't dumb, they're going to figure that out. They're going to actually see the behavior of the central bank present or past and say, well, I don't buy that. And as a result, I'm going to get ahead of the game and ask for higher pay increases. I'm going to ask for higher interest rates. I'm going to basically preempt the central bank. So that's the Barrow-Gordon logic. The most important part about the Barrow-Gordon logic would be that if you're in a country like Italy in the 1970s or 80s, you're facing a very high rate of inflation. People expect you to do that, and no amount of cajoling or jawboning will change that. It's a bad equilibrium. It's bad for everybody. The people don't like it either, but they've got the central bank. It's just not credible. And this is always a problem when you're trying to conquer a hyperinflation. When I talk about a hyperinflation, I'm talking about 50% per month. It's really hard for the Bank of Zimbabwe to make any credible statement because the guy who runs Zimbabwe was reaching his hand into the till every month to pay his employees, and this is his clientele, etc., his soldiers. So, my goodness, how do you expect that to work? So people just stop using the currency and you have a situation like that. So the European Monetary Union is a way of fixing that. Imagine if we could actually credibly tell the Greeks in 1980 or the Italians in 1980, we're going to move to a new world where these guys in Frankfurt, one of the most credible money places on the continent, is going to be determining monetary policy. And you have a person on the board, so it's kind of attractive. In fact, we're going to make it one person, one country. So there's quite a bit of attractiveness for doing that. Well, if people expect it to work, it's going to work. And it wasn't just the monetary union. I'll show you that it has worked. There are a few catches, and we'll come to that in a second. But there's certainly evidence that the European Central Bank has a low inflation preference, and it's also responding a little bit to output, so it's not like these are like completely indifferent people to the outcome of the real economy. And we've seen that in the behavior of this very young central bank. In recessions, it has tended to cut interest rates. In booms, it has tended to raise interest rates. Ceteris paribus. And this is a great example. This is from the book. They just take a simple Taylor rule. John Taylor proposed this rule, leaning against the wind, summarized by coefficient A, and stimulating when the output gap is negative and pulling back when raising interest rates when the output gap is positive fits pretty well. You can use econometrics to do it. This is just a simple pick a value, 1.5 for A and, 0.5 for B and see what happens. Okay, so a lot of, Taylor made a big splash by actually using econometrics to estimate these Taylor rules. So if Italy can get into this Taylor rule of the ECB, which is run by, in Frankfurt, by all these tough central bankers, then people, we believe this is the case, so we condition our behavior on the rule. The fundamental idea, you've learned it in a lot of macro courses with my colleague, Lutzvainke, rules are better than discretion, right? Because discretion confuses people. They don't know what this guy's going to do, and they assume the worst. Here we have a rule, and it's not even, the Greeks have a very small vote. Okay, so in some sense, on the monetary side, it's a great deal. Question is, there are other problems that we'll talk about next week, the fiscal side, which has nothing to do with the composition of the monetary authority. It has a lot to do with the way the firm, the countries themselves behave. And by doing so, they can actually influence the way the central bank behaves. Okay, so theoretically it can work. There's lots of ways of doing this, but you don't have to have a fixed exchange rate. You can have the Taylor rule without a fixed exchange rate. So the inflation targeting rule of the Bank of England is well known. Italy is a different example. These are both countries that had high inflation in the 1970s. So that's clearly an interesting thing for economic historians to look at. You can also have a currency board. Right? So you can basically make your central bank into sort of a swap agency for currency. So if you need money in Estonia, or if you needed Estonian money in the mid-1990s, you just took your foreign exchange to the bank and they gave you some kroons. And they did so at infinitely elastic supply of 8 D-marks to the kroon. And if you wanted suddenly to have D-marks, they had to give you the D-marks. There was no discretion. It's like a big foreign exchange bureau. That's called a currency board. And many countries have tried that, sometimes very successfully. I think Estonia is a great example. Argentina also tried it and failed spectacularly. Okay? Now, this kind of hooks into what I'm going to talk about now. This is kind of a way of motivating whether Europe is a monetary optimal currency area or not. This has to do with the way adjustment occurs. I remind you, we had four principal adjustment mechanisms. You know, one was the relative price mechanism. When S equals 1, then sigma, the real exchange rate defined the way we do in macro, the price of our stuff in euros divided by the price of their stuff in euros, like a terms of trade, that thing has to do a lot of heavy lifting to adjust. So your inflation rate, the rate of change of P and P star in the respective regions, have to deviate for a long time to get the levels in line. Remember that. That's important. Changes in the rates of change for those two capital letters there, P and P star, will cause sigma to go into motion. And when sigma changes, then the demand for goods and services coming from the relative the export-import side will also change. Labor mobility, that was another potential criterion we talked about. Kind of goes back to our old ideas that we talked about earlier. Capital mobility, fiscal policy, and the rest. So getting to the first one, it's important to understand, how can the real exchange rate change? How could Michigan or Greece make sigma go down when they don't have capital S anymore to work with? Okay, so the interesting thoughts you can sort of, bring to bear on this idea. First off, you could imagine that sigma is not susceptible to a single definition. Sigma is the real exchange rate as we've defined it in macro, but it could be defined in a number of different ways. You can define it as the relative price of exports to imports. That would work, right? That's often called the external terms of trade. You could also think about the price of non-traded goods or non-tradable goods. Take the price, and this again, since we have a common currency, it's very likely the law of one price will make PT star equal to PT. The star means the foreigners. Okay, so price of traded goods, the price of non-traded goods in terms of traded goods. Okay, so think hard about what that means. Traded goods is stuff we export and import, And the non-traded goods are the stuff that we can't, we have to consume it here. Your apartments are non-traded goods, and they're very important. Fraction of GDP that's spent on on dwelling is quite significant. You've got haircuts, entertainment, transport, all those things go into this non-traded side. So let's think about what this means. Let's define sigma using the most general formulation we can imagine, which is to take P and P star as being geometric means of two prices. One is the price of non-traded, the other is the price of traded. And since we don't have an exchange rate, we can consider the same price in both. So I've got a price index for traded goods in France, I've got a price index for traded goods in Germany, and I've got a price index for non-traded goods in France and non-traded goods in Germany. If we assume that the Germans and the French have the same preferences, that would mean that the utility function is identical. Now you can argue with that at the micro level. The French like clothes more than the Germans do, but the Germans like cars more than the French do. And you can see that in the data. The Germans like beer, the French like wine. But if you aggregate up to traded and non-traded, these differences aren't that important anymore. They're more of a microeconomic nature. So we can just take the Cobb-Douglas assumption, and you may remember that the Cobb-Douglas preference implies an exact price index, which is simply a geometric mean of the prices. So if you take the logarithm of that expression for P and P star, you get a weighted average of the logarithms, the natural logarithms, of the price of the non-traded bundle and the price of the traded bundle. And since we have a common currency, we don't have to worry about euros versus drachma or dollars. It's all the same. It's all in single currency, euros, if you like. So we're talking about differences within the European Union. So construct the ratio of P to P star. It's a standard definition of sigma without a nominal exchange rate. And you see that a geometric mean is easily reshuffled, reorganized to look like that. So it's the price of, it's a ratio, it's a weighted average, a geometric average of the ratios of non-traded prices to non-traded prices abroad and traded prices to traded prices abroad. Okay? And the weights of the respective exponents in the Cobb-Douglas preference. Now you can do this more generally. You can do this with a CES, constant elasticity of substitution, utility function. You can use even more complicated specifications which allow for changing budget shares, because the nice thing about the Cobb-Douglas function is it has the consumer spends a constant fraction of income on each one of these items in the utility function when that consumer is optimizing utility with a fixed resource or budget constraint. Okay, so that's the case. We can basically ask the following question. If traded goods are so similar in terms of the basket that you can actually consider them as being the same thing, and we have competition, we can use what's called the law of one price. So if I take a bundle of traded goods from France and a bundle of traded goods for Germany and compare them, the price of those averaging out are pretty much the same. So that means that P star is equal to PT star is equal to PT. And therefore that first part of the product disappears. And we've got basically an exponential function. And remember, alpha is less than one. Alpha is exactly that budget share, okay, of non-traded goods at home relative to non-traded goods abroad. And this sounds really easy. Mathematically, it's trivial, but it's really important. This means basically if you impose the law of one price and you have similar preferences, similar baskets, then the whole action is coming from non-traded goods. This is like one of the most important things you can learn today. Right? We say that a country is overvalued relative to another, it means that their non-traded goods prices are actually higher. So think of Norway, very wealthy country. Has anyone ever bought a beer in Norway? So for me, beer is a very important product. Pizza is also important to me. Okay, so I was in Norway about a year ago, and I couldn't believe that Norwegians were willing to pay 12 euros for a beer and 25 euros for a pizza. Now, in Berlin, that's pretty high. Now, those goods are not traded. If I put a pizza in a box and sent it to Norway, it would not be edible. Okay, so those types of arbitrage, and beer is too heavy, so those arbitrage possibilities are not. And Norway also has all sorts of measures to keep German beer out of the country, because it's not part of the EU. So that explains to me, at least, why these non-traded goods prices are much higher. So why are they higher? It's because Norwegians have lots of money. It's a very wealthy country. They have a sovereign wealth fund with about 800 billion euros in it, and oil everywhere, and they're saving it. They're not spending it like Great Britain did in the 1970s or Holland did in the 1960s. Okay, so we call this the internal exchange rate, and it's a very important predictor of what's going to happen. So if you look at Europe in 1999 and Europe in 2009, you saw that the real exchange rate deteriorated or appreciated for all the southern periphery countries. Okay, and I'll show you the picture in a second, probably next week actually, but you'll see it. This is not just accumulation of inflation. This is basically, for some reason, countries were able to, for a long time, sustain higher non-traded goods prices. And there are many interpretations of that. One is the country's richer. So you might say, well, the Greeks were just richer than the Germans for all those years, and that's why they had this real appreciation. That's somewhat implausible. More plausible story would be that non-traded goods are sheltered, and even after the recession, price adjustments were slow to come in those areas. But again, you can make the argument that a country like Saudi Arabia, which has a lot of wealth, or Norway, or actually within a country, Stuttgart or Hamburg, very wealthy cities in Germany, will have higher non-traded goods prices. Okay, so that's something we have to remember and consider. It could also be a steady state condition. It might be for a long, long time. Norway will just be more expensive. London will be very expensive. Paris, relative to Berlin. So, you know, it's hard to change the external terms of trade, but a devaluation may actually work in a different way. It may actually just make people poor who are holding the domestic currency, want to buy foreign goods, and therefore they spend less, and therefore they drive down the price of non-traded goods. There's also the Balassa-Samuelson effect, which I presume you've all seen before, which is really interesting. It's a more indirect effect, which says that if the local economy is actually productive, so if you're Stuttgart, it's not because you've got tons of oil, but it's probably because workers in Stuttgart are very productive in the tradable goods sector, and therefore they have higher income at any price level compared to Berlin, and therefore they buy more non-traded goods compared to Berlin, and therefore the non-traded goods, because they're not traded, are more expensive. Okay, so it doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing to have an overvalued exchange rate in this sense. Overvaluation is a relative term. It can be a sign of imbalance. It can also be a sign of just relative wealth and prosperity. So the best example of this is the famous Big Mac Index. So I'm not making an ad for the Big Mac. I'm the last person to do that. But it's a great example of a basket of stuff that is traded and non-traded. Okay, so you know, a Big Mac is not just non-traded output. There is traded output in there. You have to think hard about it. But the inputs to the Big Mac generally come from all over the world, including the copyright or the trademark for the name Big Mac. So this exercise, the economists do this every year. It's brilliant. I haven't updated it because it's actually very interesting. In 2010, it was right after the financial crisis started, so you had lots of fluctuation in nominal exchange rates, which were unmatched by price changes in the Big Mac in the U.S. and abroad. So the idea is to take the U.S. Big Mac price, $3.73 in dollars, take the current exchange rate and multiply the respective Big Mac price in their respective country. Argentina, 14 pesos. Canada, four Canadian, 17. Or Chile, 17.50. These are all very large and varying numbers, but if you take the exchange rate, it usually cancels it out. We get a very, very, very reasonable number. So Chile, you know, it's almost parity. If you look at Russia, it's a little bit different. You look at Denmark, 45.9% more expensive for an American to get his Big Mac. And this is a standardized product. Remember, the Big Mac is, that's the, you may hate McDonald's, but it's a standardized product. It's like going to Starbucks. The coffee you get there is, it's got the reputation of Starbucks. Or if you buy a Mercedes-Benz, you know, you got that, but that's a traded good. Here you've got this kind of mix, mostly non-traded components here. So we have really big fluctuations. You can see, you know, Egypt minus 42% relative to the U.S. We can flip through here, and there are all sorts of fantastic. This is a very good predictor of what happens to price levels in the medium run. So a lot of economists have used these data, the panel of data for many countries, and tried to predict where the nominal exchange rate is going, and it works pretty well. So in Denmark, the prediction would be, well, either the Danish price level is going to slow down or the American is going to pick up relative to the Danes. But the Danes have a crown which is pegged to the euro, so it's going to take a while for that to happen. But if you look over 10 years, it does happen. It's really fascinating. So you can take yourself on a walk through many different countries. And generally, you see that countries that are doing well economically, that have high productivity in non-traded goods, in traded goods, and of course that, if you remember the Bolasie-Samuelson effect, that has to do with the fact that productivity in non-traded goods is actually not that different across countries. Stuttgart may have very productive auto workers compared to Poland, but a guy cutting hair in Poland and Stuttgart have the same productivity. You can't, like, you know, give the guy super scissors or something. It's just just a standard, or, you know, all sorts of activities you can think of that are pretty, you know, moderate productivity growth, and that's going to drive this result. Anyway, so you get lots of action there, and that makes this a very interesting phenomenon. Okay, so it's also interesting to, if you're interested, you know, take a look at what's happened to the price of Big Macs in Greece since the financial crisis. Okay, or Portugal. Okay, so now let's move to the most important part of the lecture today, which is Europe an optimal currency area? So I'm going to try to answer this question, and I'll give you the answer. You already know the answer. The European Monetary Union is not an optimal currency area. We can try to be political about it and put lots of paint on it and say that, you know, you got to be, you know, got to listen to the Beethoven's Ninth Symphony and get all fired up. But fact is, Europe is just not making the grade, but it's so differentiated, and I'm going to have a positive note, which is that part of the fulfillment of the optimal currency area criteria is endogenous. You can't really just say forever Europe will not be able to meet this grade. I mean, you can see it in the case of Northern Europe. In any case, I'll show you that using statistics. So this is an old idea. You know, I don't know if you know anything about Charlemagne or Karl der Große, Charlemagne. You know, in the 800s, this guy was really amazing. He just go around conquering everything, and wherever he went, he established his currency. So the guy was not stupid. The guy was really clever. He understood that by controlling the coinage, it was had his picture on it. Of course, that's also kind of nice. I don't think it was just pure vanity. I think he understood that by establishing a common standard for the coinage, they didn't have paper money back then, it was made using silver, so he had to have assayers, but these guys were loyal to him, and they were established by him, so it was like a little mint for all the different places that he conquered, and you could establish a common currency, and this could also be a unifying effect. But it turns out that when he died, Europe was not ready for this, and his kingdom sort of deteriorated into a bunch of little fiefdoms. And Pippin the Hunchback has a very interesting role to play in that. If you're interested, check out early Middle Age European history. It's quite interesting. So let's take those criteria that we've already discussed, including the credibility, and look and see what happens. So factor mobility, symmetry of shocks, open economy versus closed, fiscal stabilizers, and the credibility issue. Let's take those individually and see what we conclude. And I hope you agree with me. Maybe you don't. So labor mobility is the big one for me. I'm a labor economist slash macro economist, so I'm very interested in this as a mechanism. And the idea is very simple. If you have Keynesian unemployment, one way to fix the problem is for people who can leave and want to leave to let them leave. It takes the pressure off the labor markets, and it's probably welfare increasing, and it can be high enough. In the United States, people estimate 3% of the American population change state every year, which is quite a bit. It seems to be going down, but it's still pretty high. So there's a famous study by Antonio Fatas, following up on an earlier study that he did with Jurk de Cressin from Belgium, where he looked at the effects of a shock that hits a region but doesn't hit all the other regions. And he basically uses a so-called structural vector order regression to estimate that. Okay, so he has long time series, or his paper with Jurk de Cressin, they had long time series on various regions in these two monetary unions. You know, Europe, he pulls together a lot of other stuff. So it's the nuts regions, including the non-euro area places, because there wasn't enough data. Obviously, 2000, paper was published in 2000. They probably used data going up to the mid-90s. But still, you know, you got an interesting set of data. And the idea is if you have an exactly identified structural vector autoregression, you don't need to know what that is for the exam, but it's all it is trying to take a regression of certain variables, here there are four of them, on their own past, and ask, is there a theoretical model that allows us to identify four different shocks? Okay, and there's several methodologies out there that allow you to do that. Having done that, you can actually call a shock the shock to employment, or the shock to, call it the shock to labor demand, or the shock to labor force participation, or to aggregate demand for goods. And you can actually trace through the effect of these shocks on the endogenous variables that we can observe. So you can't observe the shocks, you have to identify them using some minimal assumptions. And then once you do that, you can actually crank out the model, estimate the model, and let the model spit out the implied shocks. Okay, so what you see here is the implied pulse response to, you know, a negative shock for employment, unemployment rate, participation, and migration. See, these two different estimates and their implied average behavior for the regions of Europe, the regions of the United States, the 50 states, and the District of Columbia are pretty instructive. I mean, if you look carefully, you see that the adjustment in Europe seems to take a little bit longer, but it's also the case that America, the U.S., tends to react to a negative shock in employment through an out-migration, so people leave. That's the black line in the lower half. In Europe, it's a much smaller amount, quantitatively much. I mean, if you did put standard errors around that, you'd certainly reject the null hypothesis that they're the same. In Europe, on the other hand, people adjust through participation. Okay, so a bad shock comes, employment shock would be reacted to by a decrease in participation. So people would leave the labor force. They'd become unemployed first. That's the first round effect. And these unemployed would be long-term unemployed, and then eventually they'd get frustrated and stop looking. They become out of the labor force. This possibility in the United States is not supported by the social welfare system, so it's very difficult to get away with doing that. Now, you may think that's good or bad. I'm just trying to describe. Don't shoot me. I'm just the messenger. This is a fairly serious study, that's been repeated in other countries and contexts. It's a nice way of trying to at least, you know, make a comparison. The interesting thing is the unemployment and employment adjustment are quite serious, similar over the long run. Of course, that's partly what they impose. But so you get the idea that Europe's reaction is not through migration. Labor's not very mobile. And what we see now, given the disastrous performance or the disastrous outcomes in Southern Europe, people are coming to Northern Europe. We also observe a lot of construction workers that migrated to Spain from Romania, for example, have left, or Poles that may have migrated to England when they had their recession, came back to Poland. So a lot of the migration is not from locals who were born there, but people who had actually showed up and have decided to go. So the labor mobility criteria leaves something to be desired. Okay, so this is a bit more detail on this particular, shock to labor demand. So again, this is a very imprecise methodology. A lot of people criticize it. There's a lot of issues about identification, but a lot of people have also repeated it, and they get similar results. The big thing to remember is that migration is the adjustment valve for the United States, which is what we'd want in a monetary union, and it's not the case in the regions of Europe. So what's the problem? Is that exogenous or not? The judgment for an economist whether something's exogenous or not is actually very tricky. Sunspots are exogenous. You know, nice weather maybe. Things like this could have institutional factors. So maybe over time European governments will agree on a way of taking your pension rights from one country to another without any problem. It's still kind of a difficult thing to do. Or unemployment benefits can be transferred. That would make it easier and less uncomfortable. Maybe Europeans start speaking English or start speaking French or German. Somewhat unlikely, but Europeans are quite good at speaking several languages, something I can't say for the United States. So this is one adjustment mechanism that could be endogenous. And I'm sure all the Spaniards and the Greeks that have come to Berlin, they're not getting by in the computer software industry by speaking Spanish or Greek, right? They're probably learning German. So there is an adjustment that's possible. The second factor mobility issue was capital. Now, this is a weaker factor because a lot of times capital will be deterred from an area that's subject to a short-run depression or recession. Maybe there are other reasons that keep capital away, but depressed regions tend to attract capital because they see an opportunity. If wages are low because of a recession, then capital rushes in there, and that can actually stimulate the economy. And we've seen that in many contexts in the United States. So, you know, this is one indication that maybe this is a possible mechanism, especially if you stare at this area, this time. This is the euphoria we had at the beginning of the monetary union. So, in retrospect, it's absurd that financial markets compressed yields on 10-year government debt at the advice of Fitch and S&P, there is no rational model for that, I can imagine. I said this last time, I say it again, especially in light of what happened afterwards. So the people who bought Southern European debt in 2008 really made a bad deal for them, for their investors, for their pension owners, whatever. Huge capital losses involved with those movements. Okay. And of course, we'll talk about that in detail later. So why did that happen? Clearly, capital was mobile, but it's also footloose and can leave very quickly because those increases in bond yields after 2009 are because people were running to the door. This is not the kind of capital mobility I'm interested in. I'm interested in physical capital that actually stays for a while. Okay, so this is not what I'm talking about. The issue of shock convergence is very interesting. So this is the second Mundell criterion. We're not going to talk about this one. This is not This was not the Mundell topic, but Mundell actually thought about it. I already mentioned it, so Europe is not going to make this one. But if we talk about private sector shocks, this is more fiscal policy stabilizing. But if you look, if you think about shocks as being exogenous, there's a lot of very good evidence. I'm going to show you, convince me that Europe could be, as a matter of degree, an optimal currency area. So I want you to pay attention to this. This is going to be on the exam. Just take note. Because this is really important. You need to make the argument when people say, oh, Europe's a crazy idea. It's not true. And these are two guys actually who are against the monetary union. So I'm going to use their evidence against them. You know, glass of water is half empty, half full. Depends on how you look at it. I'm going to try to convince you that their evidence, a very nice paper published in 1994, actually makes the case that if you do the right things, maybe countries can converge. Okay, so what they did is they computed sigma, computed ratio of price indexes at home and abroad for regions of Germany. In fact, they took the West German six Bundesländer, the Flächenländer. Okay, so they took the ones that actually aren't cities, and they calculated relative exchange rates. And they took averages over the six Länder. So this is basically, these numbers are averages of the six Länder with themselves and measured as the standard deviation of changes in the real exchange rate. Okay, that's the shocks. I mean, you can, the original paper had first differences in the logarithm. So it's just a volatility measure. So that if you're in a bachelor thesis, you could get away with, if you did a good job on this, I'd like to see that. No one has ever done this for me, but I've been asking for it for years. To do this exercise with new data, because they did their exercise with data going up to the 1990s. So just taking first differences in the logs of these bilateral real exchange rates is enough to get the mileage, but the referee apparently asked them for more detail. They have to do sort of a vector auto regression, statistical fancy stuff, and it still works. Okay? So let's look at this. So BA is Bavaria, and 16 is the variability during this period, 73 to 1978, of Bavaria's real exchange rate with Berlin. Actually, Berlin is not a Flächenland, so sorry about that. Baden-Württemberg, Hesse, North Rhine-Westphalia, and the Saarland. Okay, so a few states got left out there. I'm not sure why, Schleswig-Holstein, but it's not very much of cows. My wife comes from Schleswig-Holstein. So look at those numbers. What do those numbers tell you? Okay, so 21 is percent. So it's percent variability. Because the standard deviation of these changes. So this is the first period, 1973 to 78. This was a period when Europe was in total turbulence. This was the snake in the tunnel period before the monetary union was instituted. Okay, so there's already turbulence even within Germany, common currency area. Now, what they do is so clever is they look at, okay, so let's compare those six Länder averages with matching them up with Austria, Belgium, Denmark, France, Italy. These are countries that have their own currency. So obviously things are going to be flopping around. We know that from last week. The nominal exchange rate is changing. This is what they get. These are huge numbers. So Britain, 217% standard deviation of the average real exchange rate of Bavaria, Berlin, Baden-Württemberg, Hesse, North Rhine-Westphalia, Saarland with the UK. So that doesn't look like a very stable arrangement. It looks like the nominal exchange rate is causing huge changes in the real exchange rate. If they had symmetric shocks, you'd expect basically the nominal exchange rate to be just canceling, at least in this data, the effect of shocks. And if there are no shocks, then these should not be very large. So this is a good example of measuring the shock. Now look at the ranking. Look at Austria. Austria looks pretty good, doesn't it? Austria would be a candidate. And we don't want to talk about that, but it could be a candidate. Belgium, nah. France, woo, no, I don't think so. So Luxembourg, Netherlands, pretty close. This is the turbulent period when they all had their own currency. After 78, you know that Helmut Schmidt, Giscard d'Estaing started the European monetary system. Look what happened then. So first, you should take a real close look at, again, these shocks are measured in this particular part of the diagram as monthly volatility, so it's easy. Like I said, anybody, any bachelor could do this. Now, if you look at the change over time of these countries, even Britain's real exchange rate volatility goes down. Britain was in the EMS for a few years, but look at Holland, the Netherlands. The Netherlands' real exchange rate volatility is pretty much reached by 1989, the level of Berlin in the 1970s. So that speaks to a very large change in the exchange rate volatility. That was accomplished by having a common currency, increased trade integration, and increased synchronization of shocks. Looking at the last period, and this is why I'd love to see somebody do this. And people have done this already, but it's very easy. You can see that the integration of the Bundesländer has kind of slowed down. It's still kind of going on. So prices are very, very harmonized, but they're also harmonized if you take Austria, Belgium, even France. I wouldn't say the same thing for the UK. I wouldn't say the same thing for Denmark. And I certainly wouldn't say it for Italy. But Italy was in the euro from the get-go. Okay, so we may have bent the rules a little bit. The rules, the Maastricht admission rules don't deal with Neumann and von Hagen, but obviously there's something in there that they overlooked. If you do it on a quarterly basis, you get even bigger volatility numbers, but you get the same conclusion. So it's not just short-run volatility. This is actually, these are basically movements of the real exchange rate, and the, including changes in the prices at home and abroad. This is a really important study. Hasn't stimulated that much interest, but I think in central banks, a lot of this analysis was carried on, and you know, it's a good indication of integration. So you know, you can have endogenous candidates for the monetary union. So I would really be nice to see whether, you know, has Italy made any progress? I'm sure it has, because the price, the rate of inflation has come down in Italy. They don't have an exchange rate anymore, so it has to have come down. The question is, how close is it to what's going on in between Germany and Luxembourg or Germany and Denmark? Because if you have a fixed nominal exchange rate or a common currency, there's one less lever that can generate movements of the real exchange rate. Let's talk about credibility of monetary policy. The ECB had a great, or has a great record on inflation. They get way too little credit. The inflation rate in the European Monetary Union in Germany is lower than it was during the Bundesbank years. The Bundesbank kind of dropped the ball at unification. Inflation really went up. And the Bundesbank was mad about that, but you know, the government was told them, hey, we're going to unify with East Germany and don't raise the interest rates for a while, and they put lots of pressure on them. Finally, they raised the interest rates after inflation was on its way up in 1992. Germany's inflation under the euro has actually gone down. So it's impossibly, it's just wrong for anyone to criticize the European Central Bank for not fighting inflation. Now, who knows what's going to happen in 5 years? We don't know. We haven't had the complete set of experiences, but at least on the past 15 years, it's done pretty well. This means that Italy and all the other countries I've cited have gained enormously from lower inflation. Italians are used to low inflation as opposed to what it was when I was a student. Greece, low inflation, still higher than Germany's, was higher than Germany's until the crisis, much higher sometimes. But anyway, lower interest rates mean lower nominal interest, lower inflation rates mean lower expectation of future inflation, means that people are willing to lend governments money. It means that interest rates come down. It means that competing assets also have lower nominal rates of return. And it means that government debt payments go down. So during this period, Italy was able to have a huge windfall on the government budget because their interest burden went down. They could have used that money to run a surplus. They could have actually run down the stock of debt, but they didn't do it as much as they probably should have. This is the overall picture that I mentioned. Up until 2005, it's in the textbook. The problem is the variation of inflation is still high. Okay, so this is something you really have to understand. The crisis is that we observe today, the sovereign debt crisis, is partially due to the world global economic crisis, which came from the United States, but it also had to do with this. This is a long-term average, you know, over 6 years after the euro was founded, inflation was persistently higher relative to the average. Now you look at Ireland, you say, well, that could be the Bolaños-Samuelson effect. We know that Ireland became very wealthy. I don't know if you've been to Ireland, but was it really 12% so quickly? Was Germany getting so poor during that period? Well, we know the Hartz reforms were important. Part of that could be the Hartz reforms, reducing labor costs. We know that was important, one of the reasons the German labor market's doing better. But it's very interesting to see this north-south divide here. Okay, so this is the lead up to the financial crisis, which hit in 2008 in the global economy and hit Europe in 2009-2010. Here's some other evidence. So in contrast to the picture with the interest rates where it all came together, wow, so beautiful, and then boom, it opened up again like a fan, here we've got inflation. So you see that there was a golden age of convergent inflation, but it's not really convergent. And if you look at the brown line is Greece. The brown line is Greece before the euro came in. It had high inflation, 8% before they adopted the euro, coming down, pretty impressive. But throughout the period, they were kind of above average. And if you're higher than somebody else by 1% per year, after 10 years, you've got a 10% real appreciation. And that can be very painful. And after the financial crisis, strangely, inflation even went higher up, probably because the Greeks raised the value-added tax and maybe people wanted to get in a last hit, get a last wage increase before the crisis happened. But Germany and Greece are on opposite ends of that scale around the period 2010 to 2012. And this is the harmonized CPI. This is what the ECB coordinates, calculates, way to compare cost of living in a consistent Laspère index way. Okay? So as a result, if you've got a higher inflation rate for many, many years, you're going to have an appreciation at the constant exchange rate. So Ireland was out in front. Spain, out in front. Portugal, out in front. And Luxembourg, they didn't have a financial crisis, strangely enough. Of course, their banks were in trouble, but could be the wealth of Luxembourg. It's a very small country. But keep going down. Portugal, you see Italy, and Greece. And you see it in terms of the price level as well. This is, the left-hand side is a measure of price competitiveness. It's kind of like unit labor costs. On the right, it's price level. Okay, so you see huge differences. And those countries at the bottom are the ones that cracked. And if you look carefully at this picture, which I actually took from the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, and for some reason you can't see the accreditation below, but I will say it so no one sues me. Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. This was done in this picture was published in 2007. And I cut that out. This is before the financial crisis occurred. This is amazing, right? And if you read the article, they basically said this can't go on forever. And the outset was right. This was the fundamental view of the financial crisis. It was already coming before the American real estate bust. It was already in the books. Okay, and real growth responded. So the countries, this is a contradictory story. The countries that grew a lot were the ones that had the real appreciation. So it looks like exactly what we said before, the aggregate demand was higher in those southern countries, maybe because the interest rates were low, they could get a quick loan, fix up their house, or they got a wage increase, the government was borrowing money to pay the wage increase. But in any case, those countries that struggled were growing faster before the crisis. Okay, it's not like they were getting killed. The countries that were getting killed have the slow rate of growth since the euro were Germany and the Netherlands. Italy is interesting. I can't rule out that there are other things going on. Italy was hit by the Chinese phenomenon. You know, competitiveness of Italian industry is well known to have suffered in the past. The interesting thing is it's even true in Denmark. So this is also, you see, I gave accreditation for the FATSET in this one. Here you see that Denmark also suffered. So it's not, I don't think it's really so obvious that it's just the euro. The Danes could have left the European Monetary Union anytime they wanted. They could have joined the European Monetary Union anytime they wanted, but they decided not to. They voted against it, and they have a central bank that's the only central bank that's still doing EMS, European Monetary System, the old-fashioned way. Okay, so they're basically locked to the euro, and you can see that their consumption, this is right-hand side, is an index of consumption, has been pretty stable, even though other countries have been doing much better. So my answer to the question I posed at the beginning is no, but be careful, because a lot of the story is endogenous, and part of the story is inflation, and inflation is part of the equation. Inflation is something that the demand side drives, and we've seen that here in this particular picture, but it's not the whole story. I'll come back to that next week. We talk about the supply side. I'm a big proponent of taking a two-handed view. It's not just demand stimulating the economies out of a problem, but you've also got to think about the potential behind the economy. So let's talk about why the European Central Bank has been so successful. First, it has in its statutes price stability. Inflation is supposed to be below but close to 2%. So they're not advocating deflation, but it's clear it's a biased towards deflation. They're not going to get punished as much in the eye of the statutes as they would for being above, for being below, than they would for being above. And, you know, this is a central bank that has the same access to all the different things that we've seen in the other central banks around the world. They have a refinancing instrument, kind of steering the overnight rate that banks would pay to each other to borrow money. And they have the so-called two-pillar approach. The other one pillar is kind of cracked. That's the monetary pillar. They're really focusing on inflation. But they kept it for a reason, I think, which is interesting. I think if you see M2 growing very, very fast for a long period of time, you might want to worry about the fundamentals of the inflation target. Okay, so that's my interpretation of what they do. So it has a balance sheet. I didn't present this before, but it's a very interesting set of numbers. You see, it looks like a regular central bank. It has lots of gold on the balance sheet. It has very little government debt, despite what you hear in the newspapers. We'll move up to 2010 in a second. But back then, very few European central banks were executing open market operations with debt as a way of injecting reserves into the system. On the contrary, they were doing what's called rediscounting, making loans directly to banks on some sort of auction basis. Okay. On the right-hand side, you see currency in circulation. That's the euros in your pocket. Reserves, liabilities that are held by the commercial banks as a means of payment among themselves, clearing. And of course, the European Central Bank does government accounts. And this is the consolidated balance sheet. So this is at the time there were much fewer than 25 countries or 20, whatever it is, 19 countries. What we did have is a lot of central banks with different policies. So the central bank of Germany and France use the government. The government uses the central bank as a way of making payments, and that shows up as well. So let's zoom up to 2009. This is 5 years later. You can see that things have changed quite a bit. The total assets is now increased by about 150%. That's not just because of the financial crisis. It's actually because many countries have come in. So it's part of the story. But the structure is the same. Claim on governments is still relatively modest. This is not the case a few years later. So this is three short years later, the volume of the length of the balance sheet has pretty much has almost doubled. Now in the Fed, it was even larger. The Fed was like saving its banking sector and saving AIG and buying lots of mortgage-backed securities. So there's a different set of parameters that the central bank of the European monetary system had to deal with. Okay, so you can see this is an important vehicle, potential way of dealing with it. And here's an interesting thing. This is something a lot of people don't realize, but since then, the European Central Bank has contracted its balance sheet, probably because of the ongoing recession, the asymmetry of the recovery. Many banks have actually run down their liabilities vis-a-vis the European Central Bank. They've scaled back lending. You might say this is a credit crunch. We're not really going to go out our way to say that, but it certainly means that they're trying to deleverage vis-a-vis the ECB. This is the instrument set. The only reason I show this is to make it clear to you that the interest rate is no longer a valid instrument for the ECB. It doesn't make any. They've even tried to have negative interest rates on balances with the ECB. It's a small signal that they're willing to do whatever it takes. But the ultimate interest rate tool would be the lower red one, which is the deposit rate facility that's gone negative now, and the pink one. This is the rate at which banks actually are lending to each other is very, very low. So this explains why the Draghi announcement happened. Everyone wants to know why he did that. The yellow line in this diagram, which I took from a publication by Bruegel, think tank in Belgium, basically the size of the ECB balance sheet, you can see how it had that little bump here in the financial crisis. But actually, it didn't do much else. It didn't look like the Fed's balance sheet at all. So it's impossible to say that the ECB was just pouring money down the throats of the banks. If anything, they were accommodating the banks' desire not to do that. Now, the crisis hit, and they did open market operations and long-term financing of purchases of assets by the member state banks, and that's this ELTRO program just starting to kick in here. You can see that they managed to reach the old trend, but since then it's gone down again. So this is kind of what provoked Draghi to announce this securities purchase program. In other words, this balance sheet, you understand how a balance sheet works, right? The central bank can lend money to the commercial banking sector, or it can actually just buy assets on the open market and force the central bank, the participating commercial banks to have money with which they should probably start lending because they're losing the opportunity. Costs of having reserves at the ECB are pretty high, or at least potentially high. So that would explain the development of this yellow line. And what I don't have is the most recent data, which seems, at least projections, what they want to do, I'll show it to you next time, is it's going up again. This is called quantitative easing. The idea is if you can't cut interest rates, you got to do something else to give the banking sector lendable reserves and make it unattractive for them to do nothing with it. Okay, so we'll continue this discussion next time. We'll talk about the Maastricht criteria. I have to mention these again next week. We'll talk about why they're so important, because we've already discussed them. We discussed last time why Germany put pressure on the treaty writers, threatening not only does it have to be in Frankfurt, but we want to have some influence on the criteria. We want to have an anti-inflation attitude, which means that at the time, the suspicion was that monetization of the deficit as a chronic effect of would punish the countries that run surpluses or even have moderate countercyclical Keynesian policies and would subsidize those countries that don't pay attention to the rules and just spend whatever they want. And if you're a small country, the incentive to do so is obviously there. Some small countries in the European Union could run deficits for the rest of our existence, and it wouldn't make a big difference in our standard of living. But if everybody does that, it becomes a problem. Because we know central banks financing deficits by purchasing debt or extending credit to these countries would be running a risk of increasing the money supply at a high rate, which can end badly if you take the long perspective. So that's why these preconditions were enforced. Next week I'll talk about these. Okay, one was inflation. Again, this is something one should really know because it's likely to be on the exam. The other is long-term interest rates. That's a way of committing to a low inflation rate tomorrow, not just today. You can always get your inflation rate down quickly, but can you keep it down for 10 years? Can you convince investors to buy your government bond, which is denominated in your currency, because they have some expectation of being able to pay it back? The debt criteria. The debt criterion deals with this notion of government debt aggregated across national, local, and provincial levels. This is an important point. The consolidation is important because a lot of countries have failed in fiscal policy management because the local governments have gotten out of control. Even though the government says we're going to run a surplus, if the states are running deficits and have no discipline, then the states can undo whatever the government's doing. You see this in China. We saw this in Argentina. We saw this in the United States in the 1830s. United States, U.S. states ran big deficit, budget deficits, or they issued lots of debt, actually, is what they did. They ran debt, and these debt finance projects went out of business, and the states said, well, we can't, you know, we're going to default unless the government bails us out. And the government, the U.S. government in that period refused to bail them out. So that was like the drawing the line in the sand 170 years ago. And as a result, a lot of states had balanced budget amendments. So the states were constraining themselves to get investors. They said, okay, we're going to prevent ourselves from borrowing. Okay, this is a perennial problem. Like I said, Argentina and possibly China right now have these issues to deal with. The deficit is the flow increment to the debt, right? So this is we'll have the formula next week. We'll talk about that. And of course, the exchange rate criterion. That's supposedly evidenced by being in the European monetary system for 3 years. Now, right now, only Denmark is in the system, so it's kind of a silly, but it's true. I think the Treaty of Maastricht still requires that. So next week, we'll talk about these in detail. Why in the world would they choose these numbers? Okay, you know, because now they're saying, okay, here it is. Inflation has to be low, but it has to be lower than the average of the three lowest inflation countries. Okay, so that's, there must be some logic behind that. Also, 60%. Very few countries meet this criteria now, but it was and can be rationalized using economics. We'll do that next week. And the deficit, the same thing. Interest rates, I already said it, and the exchange rate stability is important to get the real exchange rate on a stable path. Okay, it's getting late. It's really hot in here. Thank you for showing up. I'd like to know where the other 110 people are that are going to take the exam. I hope they show up too. Have a nice week and have a nice day.